shift of thinking was, if you look at this very classical, very formal facade, if you look at it from the side, it is somewhat of a stage piece. Mm-hmm. This is not a gable that follows that shape, so it is somewhat of a false front. And I like that little kind of twist on the theatrical front that is no longer the functional front. Mm-hmm. And that was a leap for the historical,
the Historic District's Commission?
Yes, the Historic District's Commission to have a front door that isn't any longer used as a front door, but I think it solved a lot of problems.
Mm-hmm. What other problems did you encounter in fitting into this 4,000 square foot frame, all of the things that the theater needed to have in here, Lewis? I know there were quite a few.
It was basically, I think, about probably 25% too small in all dimensions for what really needed to happen in here. And so it was a series of ingenious on the part of structural engineer Chuck Lysett and Curtis in terms of compacting everything. So everything had to be squeezed in here very efficiently. And even our electrical contractor and how
kind of
had to run all the conduits. But I think the most interesting kind of challenges were this lobby space, for one, because there were so many things that do need and were identified as needs to happen in here, and it's just not a big space. I do think dropping the floor makes it feel much bigger than it would have otherwise, and so you sort of get some borrowed space from the volume. So just kind of thinking how this could be a ticket booth, a cafe, a library, a coffee shop, and a lecture hall was pretty interesting. And then the other technical challenge, which just gives me great pleasure to look at now, is how to get the vertical dimensions that we need, because we have to have tiered seating to get the sight lines, and we have to have, or we really wanted this balcony, which that's what really, I think, gives it that kind of immediacy of the experience in here. And to do that, if you look at the thickness of that balcony, it's about this thick in its entirety. And that, from just an engineering detail and an architectural detail, was very challenging, and it's very satisfying to see something that is that kind of expressive of the problem.
I also think the project was charmed, actually, because if the grade was a foot higher, if
it was down to the inch.
It was down to the inch. And if the roof pitch was just a little steeper and therefore the interior is just a little lower, it wouldn't fit. And if it wasn't this magic proportion and height that it happened to be to make it hard but possible, it never would have happened.
So. And then there are these very weird kind of structural trusses, or I'm not even sure if they would be called trusses. I guess
beams.
in the main space that were infilled with brick, mm-hmm. and which is unusual, so that there's a flat beam and then this kind of A-shaped to form the pitch of the roof above that, and we just couldn't find the space for the ductwork. Mm-hmm. So we had to re-engineer those things structurally and cut out enough space to run the ducts in that very narrow space that was filled with brick, take a brick out and add some other structure. So there were lots of little engineering challenges to get the space.
And another little bit of engineering magic was the inspiration is the fabric duct out there, because normally it would have been a metal duct that had a liner on it and it actually wouldn't have fit in the hole again. Had the mechanical engineer not set up and said, ooh, we can use this, you know, this fabric duct instead. Again, it wouldn't have fit. Mm-hmm. It would have been stuck.
Which from a design point of view too, one of the great things about this project to me was that it was truly collaborative in the largest sense of the word from the very beginning. I mean, I've rarely been so involved with a client as with Jerry and Simi, and everyone sort of locking on to this vision of this very visceral kind of raw space that had the immediacy and the kind of the power that kind of fit the theater model of Burning Coal. And then every step of the way, by necessity, mm-hmm. we had to all be putting our heads together to solve all these problems that normally would be often little compartments, you know, more so. The engineer is normally simply designing a balcony or designing a ductwork distribution, but in this case, that would never work because everything had to fit so perfectly for it to get into this volume of this building.
Greg, can you describe some of the peculiarities that you came across when you were excavating the space and then building it out?
Well, the structural system, both the floor and the ceiling, were early fireproof concrete construction. So there were actually, going across the floor, cast-in-place concrete beams all the way across that we had a jackhammer out. It was a real mess to get it down to the lower level. And then the roof was built that same way with almost inch and a half thick plaster ceiling. So that sort of helped us out in an engineering way, in that we were taking as much weight away from the ceiling as we were adding with the balcony. So that was a little stroke of luck there. We still had to beef up the beams. The cross section of the beam was just a little bit smaller than Chuck was happy with, so he had us add these rods to each side of the beam welded in place. I had welders in the main body of the theater for about a month and a half spray doing the structural work. So that was a big deal. But I think the biggest challenge was getting all the electrical work in place. We really had two full systems of the building system and the performance lighting system, and the sheer number of miles of wire and conduits is just mind blowing.
The building had nothing in it when we started the infrastructure.
Right. I like to say that mechanical systems that we took out included six radiators, one light fixture, and two switches. So, a
little different now.
Really, the mechanical and plumbing systems together constituted about 60% of the cost of the project. But the electricians were actually on the job from day two. Not day one, we had to do a little digging first to level the floor. But on day two, they arrived on the job, and they were here literally the day that the first show was being mounted. Curtis was in one room with a cell phone, I was in the other room with a cell phone, and the electrician was in the back room flipping switches as people were entering the room. So he was here from day two
till the bitter end.
Set the bar for everybody who wanted to put a piece of something into the, especially the auditorium space itself. Just everybody was very respectful of, we all have to fit our stuff in here and we all want it to look good. So mm-hmm. It was very satisfying.
And one of the things for me when you walk into a theater during construction, to get a really good hint as to how things are going and whether this is going to cat into a bag at the end or go, okay, is you look at the conduit beds and see what the electrician did. And these were beautiful. This was artistry that he did, and I knew we were going to be okay when I saw that.